How do you explain stillness to someone who's always running? You can find answers to almost any question online. How to change the squeaky wheel of your dishwasher, how to take better photos, how to take better focus, how to be more productive, how to talk to your spouse, and all those things. But the information you get doesn't make the actual difference. It's something else. And in order to explain that something else, I again, like in a previous video, need the help of Hans Zimmer's music, and I need to take you outside with me to show you something. Now let's start with that simple exercise. I just went outside to go balancing on a rail. And if you've ever done that barefoot, you know what that probably feels like. And if you wanted to learn how to balance, you would find probably a million different videos explaining you all that. And the majority of the videos online will probably cover what to do with your limbs, because that's the most obvious thing to do. What to do with your limbs and where exactly to look. And some people will say you need to look on the rail. Some people will say you need to look straight ahead to one single point of focus, and others will say something different. So if there's this different information out there, what is actually the thing that makes you able to balance on a rail? Especially because it's also possible, obviously, to balance on a rail without the use of your arms to balance. And the thing with any challenge, the thing with anything you're trying to do, taking better focus, being more productive, whatever it is, there's always one underlying principle to understand. There is something behind all that information, behind all the limbs, that's the actual core of the challenge. The thing with balancing, if you've ever tried it, once you understand what balance feels like and you are able to detect it in your body, you will be able to exploit the very thing. You will be able to exploit that balance, because suddenly you're able to do things that previously didn't think were possible. So by now you might be thinking, okay, what does this have to do with Hans Zimmer's music? And I have covered Hans Zimmer and his genius in one of my previous videos, which I have a link up here. What I want to focus on today is this. Hans Zimmer, like nobody else before in the business, was able to detect underlying principles of human emotions and then exploit them. So now the first track I've chosen is from one of his first really breakthrough movies. It's called The Thin Red Line. It was published in 1998, and I've picked this track because here, for the first time, Hans Zimmer has done something in his work and also generally in making scores that I don't want to reveal just yet, but let's listen in. What can you hear in the background? He's doing something here that hadn't been done before, but since then has been copied by himself and by others. Because the scene that we're listening to right now, I'm not showing you the images, but it's trying to create tension. And up until then, in scores, composers used similar sounds to do that. You might remember some of the sounds that I'm thinking of. But what he did there was he drilled down to what's actually creating the tension here. And what's creating the tension is the time ticking away. I'm getting goosebumps I don't need to watch the film in order to do that. You will find the song, of course, linked below because it's copyright protected, so you'll be able to listen to it in full. So what he did here, look for the underlying principle emotionally that creates the tension. And in that case, of course, that tension has to do with the time ticking and running away. And that very ticking sound is something that Hans Zimmer also repeated in some of his later works. So to emphasize this a little more, let's also listen to a second track, which is from the movie Interstellar. This is how the track begins. If you've seen the movie, that's a scene when the protagonists land on a foreign planet. And being on that foreign planet means that time is ticking away faster. So 1 year spent on that planet means 7 years on Earth. And so in the beginning of that track, the ticking is very slow. However, later, the ticking has increased. And you see, while in the background, the main motive is growing, the main motive that will later be played by church organs and all such things, it's still that tension. And it's still that clicking and that time ticking away in the foreground. Tell me if your heart rate is raised at the moment. Mine is. And I'm not even watching the movie. Listen to it in full. I really recommend it. So what is he doing here? He identified the underlying principle behind tension. And the underlying principle behind tension in those cases is the time is running away. And people are afraid of losing touch. People are afraid of maybe losing control over a situation. And that's where I see the connection to balancing on a rail. That might not be obvious in the first moment to you, but I think it's very clear. Because the balancing on a rail, if we focus on what's out here, if we focus on the limbs and where to look, we'll always be distracted from the very thing that actually causes stability and the very thing that actually helps us to create stillness. And in the balancing a rail case, it's the core. It's the distance from our hips to whatever object I'm trying to balance on. So where does it leave us? We want to maybe repair the squeaky wheel of our dishwasher, or we want to become better at taking photos. We want to become better at videography, or we want to become better balancers. Whatever it is, I think it comes down to a three-word phrase. And a three-word phrase I didn't invent myself, but I read in a really cool book. The book is called Crucial Conversations. It's by four authors that I never manage to remember, so I have to read them to you. They're called Carrie Patterson, Joseph Granny, Ron McMillan, and Al Switzler. And the title of the book already says it. It's called Crucial Conversations, Tools for Talking When Stakes Are High. So it's a book about very important conversations where there are opposing opinions and where people are emotionally involved. And there is a phrase in there that I really like. It's just three words. It's called learn to look. Because that's the challenge with crucial conversations and also with changing the squeaky wheel of your dishwasher or taking better photos or being able to shoot better videos. You need to be able and you need to learn to look for the underlying principles. And with crucial conversations, it's about getting a sense for when there are opposing opinions and emotions are rising and somehow people don't talk to each other anymore, but they start to kind of miss each other's points and keep holding back information, for example. And for me, that has two immediate consequences. Number one is my own creation process, because there are some things where I think I get to that basic understanding or I've identified an underlying principle that I cannot find in any other content. And so I'm trying to leverage that and I'm trying to talk about that and I'm trying to explain what I think is the underlying principle. And I think you should try to do that too, especially if you are an expert in something, if you understand something where you think maybe others are still talking about the limbs, but you are actually at the core and you know what the core is. And the second consequence, which I can also recommend to you, is connected to how I consume any content myself. Because a lot of the content you will find out there that is trying to explain something only focuses on the limbs, only talks about the peripheries and not the underlying principles. But in many cases, that can be very distracting and actually leading away from the main point. So I'm trying to focus my attention on the sources that are trustworthy and that can actually pick up that core. And for some weird reasons, I can find a lot of these things rather in music, in the arts, and in other creative disciplines than in the conventional disciplines where people in fact try to explain something, but in the end, maybe didn't understand what it's actually about. And I think going forward, if we want to develop society further, if we want to move on as a whole, then we need to learn to look for the underlying principles and we need to find a way to communicate them like Hans Zimmer so masterfully does. And on that journey, I hope you're joining me.